I'm going to take a solo and I'm only allowed to play on one string. Why should I want to do such a ridiculous thing, I hear you ask? All will be explained shortly. And I should say that although I'm playing over a blues progression in this video, it's not a blues lesson per se. I think that the ideas I'm going to be discussing you can apply to any style of music. And I promise if you give them a try, you will see some serious improvements in your soloing. So let me start by having a play and seeing what happens. Quite fun, maybe not the best blues solo I've ever played, but certainly very different from what I would normally play over a blues in E. So what's this one string thing all about then? Well, when I'm practicing, I'm a big fan of these kind of exercises that are based on rules or restrictions of some kind. And it forces you to play differently, it forces you to play more thoughtfully, I think. And the chances are the longer you've been playing, the more likely you are to fall into habits and to end up playing the same old thing all the time. And this is a really good way of shaking things up. So this is not an original exercise. I've seen lots of people doing similar kind of things. I think I first came across it in this book here, Mick Goodrick's The Advancing Guitarist, which is it's a classic work of guitar pedagogy, if that's the right word. And it's a brilliant book, but it's also frequently quite an annoying book. And I occasionally find myself getting it out and I'll work my way through one or two pages of this kind of thing. And then I'll throw it up against the wall in disgust. In all seriousness, it's an excellent book and well worth checking out if you don't already know it. And Mick Goodrick calls these kind of exercises disadvantage exercises. And he's got plenty of examples of this kind of thing in the book. So what are some of the advantages of these disadvantage exercises? I think there are many reasons why working on this kind of thing can be good for you. And I think the main thing is it forces you to see the guitar and to come at the guitar in a new way. I think for most of us, we see the guitar primarily as a position-based instrument. I mean, from your very first guitar lesson, you're going to be learning the minor pentatonic scale, these kind of box shapes. And even when you get more advanced and you're learning other patterns and you're trying to connect them together, there's still very much this sense that it's easier to move this way on the guitar than it is to move up and down this way. So this kind of thing is going to force you to leave behind all of your box patterns and all of the related cliches and licks, and it's going to force you to start moving this way. Another advantage of this kind of thing is you're going to be forced to use your ear a lot more, and you're probably going to end up playing more melodically. I mean, particularly with the blues, there's a real tendency to rely on stock phrases and cliches. There's nothing necessarily wrong with that. I think a part of the blues is that some of those old cliches do sound really good. But if all you're doing is just regurgitating these stock licks, then I don't think your playing is going to have much personality. So by playing on one string, you're forced to leave those licks behind. And you can no longer really think in terms of scales either. You're just thinking about the value of the actual notes themselves. So you've got a note, and then it's very easy to see visually the intervals, the distance between the notes. And ideally, you want to be hearing stuff in your head and then trying to bring that out on the guitar. You'll also find this is going to improve your technique. I think if you're just playing positionally across the strings, then all of the notes are right there under your fingers and it's fairly straightforward to move from one note to the next. But if you're playing along the length of one string, then it's a lot tougher to find melodies and to make things smooth. So you're going to be forced to work on things like sliding and stretching and position shifts, and it's much more of a challenge to create ideas and lines that flow if you're playing in this kind of way. And finally, I think this will bring you closer to the music, and it will force you to be more expressive. And this is related to the point that I made earlier about when you're playing on one string, you can no longer access all of those licks and cliches. So what you have to do is focus on the really important stuff, which is the actual notes themselves, the meaning of the notes, about how you articulate the notes, about rhythm and timing. Let me try and get specific then and demonstrate some of this stuff. I've put together a Blues in E backing track, and if you've made the sensible decision to sign up to my Patreon page, then you'll be able to access this specific backing track. But if not, don't fear, I've heard there are other Blues in E backing tracks available. So I'm only allowed to play on the B string, and I'm going to start by just using my ear. I'm not going to think in terms of theory or scales or licks. And all I need is a starting point. That's going to be this E note here at the fifth fret on the B string. And then I'm just going to see where my ear leads me. I'm going to try and hear melodies. I'm going to try and hear intervals and the distance between the notes and just see what happens. And it might force me to play more sensitively. I'm going to try and use a little bit of space. I'm going to try and play some interesting things rhythmically. So let's see what happens. So you always want to be using your ear, but I think it's useful to sometimes back that up with a little bit of theory and a little bit of knowledge. So next I might start thinking about the root notes of the specific chords that I'm playing over, and maybe some of the surrounding tones as well. So you've got your E root note here, it's the root note of the one chord of a blues in E, and then next door to that, two frets lower, we've got the flat seven. And you can find those notes for the other two chords in the blues. So for the four chord, you've got an A root note here, and you've got the flat seven, two frets below. And then you've got the same thing for the B chord, which is the five chord. So you've got a B root note here, or you've got an open B string, which you can play as well. So I'll take another little solo. I'm going to try and play around with those kind of ideas. So continuing to think about the notes and the intervals that are going to work over these chords, we could introduce some thirds. And remember, with the blues, you've got the choice to colour each of the chords in the blues and make them major or make them minor, bring out those characteristics of the chord. So again, if we start from this E root note here, you've got the minor third, which is three frets higher. And then you've got the major third, which is four frets higher. And the major third, it's quite nice to bend up to that from the second. So you've got the root second, bending up to the third. And you can do that with each of the chords in the blues. So you just need to find those root notes. Here's the root note for A, the minor third, and the major third. And then the same thing with the five chord with the B7. So I'll take another solo and I'll try some of that stuff. I want you to try experimenting, try some weird stuff, try doing some different stuff. And some of this stuff might work, some of it might not, but at least you're exploring these possibilities. Clearly, along the length of one string, sliding is an excellent technique to use, and I quite like the sound of these quite extreme slides. So, those kind of ideas. Might be good playing around with some stretches as well and seeing what happens there. So, maybe making use of that open B string. So go crazy, try and be original. It might not always work, but who cares? The gear I'm using today, guitar, is my Shergold Provocateur, and this was very kindly given to me by Shergold a while back. And after the initial excitement of being given a free guitar by somebody has worn off, I do actually still find myself reaching for this guitar. It's a very comfortable guitar to play, sounds great, in particular like the sound of these pickups. I'm not sure exactly what they are, they're Seymour Duncan pickups, but today I was using the bridge pickup. Works really well for blues and rock stuff. The amp I'm using is my Marshall Studio Vintage, and that wasn't given to me for free, unfortunately. I had to pay for that with my own money, but it was worth it. It's a great sounding amp. I'm going into the high treble channel on the bottom input. I've got the volume fairly high. It's on about 6, and although it's a studio amp and it's designed to get those plexi sounds at more reasonable volumes, it's still really loud. You could probably hear it starting to feed back when I was playing the solo at the start of this video. And I've got the amp set loud enough so it's just naturally breaking up. And then on top of that, I'm using one pedal, which is the Analog Man Beano Boost, and that's a Dallas Rangemaster style treble booster. Let me quickly give you some sound. So this is the guitar going straight into the amp with no pedals. And then switching on the Beano Boost. That's it for this video. Have fun with your one string solos. I really do urge you to have a try at this. It's a very powerful way to improve your soloing. And obviously there are lots of different places you can take this exercise. You can try soloing on some of the other strings. You can try it over a blues in some different keys. And it doesn't have to be a blues. It works well for exploring single scales or sounds. So try doing it with a major scale on one string or a minor scale or something modal. If you want a real challenge, you could try playing over a jazz standard or something like that on one string. So take something like All the Things You Are or something really difficult and then try playing through those changes on one string. A really challenging exercise. I'm going to tab out my intro solo if anyone's interested. I'll put that up on the Patreon page along with the backing track. Thanks very much for watching. I shall see you next time.